Welcome to the second webinar series of talk from Kerala Forest Research Institute. Today we have with us Dr. E. M. Muralitharan to talk to us on the tissue culture of forest trees. This webinar is joined by the director KFRI, Dr. Shyam Vishwanath. So my job is to introduce Dr. E. M. Muralitharan and to start off the lecture. Dr. Muralitharan Nenath Mavitan is hailing from Kannur. He did his BSc and MSc at Calicut University. He passed with the first rank in MSc from University of Calicut. He did his PhD at the University of Pune. And he has also done a diploma in bamboo technology from the China National Bamboo Research Center, Hangzhou People Republic of China in 2002. He had been a CSIR junior and a senior research fellow at the Central Chemical Laboratory, Pune. And he was also a project fellow in NABARD project at NCL, Pune. He then continued as a senior scientific assistant supported by Department of Biotechnology at NCL, Pune. And then he joined the Kerala Forest Research Institute as a scientist in the Forest Genetics and Biotechnology Division. His major research areas are tissue culture of forest. Species like teak, bamboo, and rattan, medicinal plants, rare and endangered plants for mass clonal propagation, clonal forestry, and conservations. The second is the DNA barcoding of live forms, including bamboo and rattan, for precise identification at species level. Third is the collection and evaluation of J plasm of bamboo, rattan, and teak. Then reproductive biology, flowering studies, and hybridization of bamboo. And he has also been active in developing tools for harvesting and management of bamboo. He has developed protocols for management of modern bamboo nurseries and bamboo plantations and certification of bamboo planting stock. He has also done work on preservation methods and processing of edible bamboo shoots. He had been chosen as the deputy coordinator of International Union of Forest Research Institutions, Unit 5.11.05, that is Bamboo and Rattan under the Division 5 of Products. He is holding the position from 2019 onwards. He is coordinator of the Bamboo Technical Support Group under the National Bamboo Mission, New Delhi, which is hosted at KFRIPG. He was the former chief editor of the Bamboo and Rattan of INBAR from 2014 to 19. He is expert member of INBAR Task Forces on Rattan Uses and Development and the Task Force of Bamboo for Bioenergy. He is member of the CUD 9 Section Committee of on Timber and Timber Stores of Bureau of Indian Standards that deals with bamboo and rattan standards. He is an expert member of Bamboo Information System in the Working Group ISO TSA 296 WG4 for rattan. He has 15 project reports to this credit, 10 publications, and he has done nearly 20 presentations across the globe. It's my pleasure to invite Dr. E. M. Muralitharan to deliver the talk. One word of question is that on the right side of your screen, you can have your chat box and feel free to pause your questions, which Dr. E. M. Muralitharan will be happy to answer at the end of the presentation. So welcome Dr. E. M. Muralitharan, welcome Dr. Shyam Vishwanath, Director KFRI. Please start the talk right now. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sajeev, for that introduction. Welcome to all. Thanks for registering for the seminar. I hope to have a good interaction at the end of the seminar. Please use the chat box to send in your questions. I shall have a presentation for you, after which we can address your questions. Okay, I'm speaking on tissue culture of forest trees, state of the art and future prospects. I have had some experience of a few decades in tissue culture of forest trees and have encountered a lot of problems, I found solutions, but some others still elude solutions. And I hope to share with you the excitement of tissue culture of forest trees. And later on, look at what future prospects are there for this technology. As I said, This webinar is to examine the progress made in tissue culture of forestries in the past 5 decades and some of the hurdles that still remain, and we look at what the future holds for the technology. I have structured this presentation in this following manner. Since I expect many of you will be students, I'll quickly go through some of the basic plant tissue culture techniques and its applications, then go on to highlight the importance of tissue culture in tree improvement and examine what progress we achieved in some of the very important tree species of India, and look at what major constraints remain in and what have we done about it, and go on to conclude with some suggestions of what the future holds for this technology. For the students particularly, this is the definition of plant tissue culture. It's also known as in vitro culture, cell, tissue, and organ culture. But more commonly, it is known as plant tissue culture, which is a technique of growing plant cells, tissues, or organs under sterile and controlled conditions on a synthetic defined nutrient medium, which is known as the tissue culture medium. A lot of chemicals are used to formulate this medium, mainly the plant growth regulators, which are used in a very judicious manner so that we get the intended results. Now, micropropagation is one of the major applications of the technique of tissue culture. Many people know micropropagation as the only application of plant tissue culture. I'll come to certain other applications in forestry. As I said, mass clonal propagation or micropropagation is the most important application, most popular application of plant tissue culture. It has certain advantages over conventional methods of propagation. You get very high multiplication rates compared to any other method. Since this is a sterile method, you get disease and pest-free plants. You should note that we are not talking about disease or pest resistance, because unless you start with a resistant plant, you will not get plants through tissue culture which are resistant. But since it is sterile, you will get the plants that come out of your test tube would be free of pests and diseases. Yeah, you can produce plants throughout the year, and that is done in a very small area. And it is possible to transfer plants across international borders without quarantine. Now, quarantine is a word which you're familiar now because it involves a lot of time and other delays. And you can imagine the advantage of transferring plants without quarantine. Coming to the application in tree improvement and breeding, we have an array of techniques, right from embryo culture, anther culture, somaclonal variation, which tree breeders find useful for their routine tree breeding applications. Some of these techniques are in routine use, for example, embryo rescue, but anther culture is a bit cumbersome, and not many successful stories are there. We have other applications like use protoplast culture, which can be used for somatic hybrids. This again is a technique which is rather difficult in practice. And then there is a method where you can culture endosperm. Since it is triploid tissue, you get triploids, which in many cases are having superior properties, better growth. Coming to plant genetic transformation, you require tissue culture techniques to create transgenics. That is, if you want to do plant genetic engineering, one essential step would be that you need a very efficient regeneration method. And in many aspects of developmental biology, cell biology, plant virology, this ability to culture plants in controlled conditions is very useful. Let's come back to micropropagation, which is the main application of plant tissue culture. This is clonal propagation through tissue culture using very small plant parts. And to get whole plants regenerated in culture, there are three different routes. The most common is proliferation of axillary meristems, where a plant part containing a meristem, which is a shoot tip or the nodal explant, is cultured. And if the medium is optimized, you would get multiple shoot formation, followed by rooting of the shoots to get complete plants. Now, there are two other methods which are not in routine use, but are useful in techniques like for applications such as developing transgenics. One is organogenesis, where you are inducing meristems on plant tissues, literally any tissue, and the principle of totipotency steps in. which says that any live cell is capable of regenerating plants. So with the proper conditions provided, mainly the correct balance of auxins and cytokines, you would get regeneration of meristems and later on shoots, which can be regenerated after rooting to plants. Somatic embryogenesis is a similar method where you induce somatic embryos, which you know that somatic embryos are bipolar. It already has a shoot meristem and a root meristem. So conversion to plantlets is easier. So these two methods are useful for techniques such as genetic transformation, whereas the first method is very useful for routine cloning of plants. Tissue culture forestries are special because although plant tissue culture techniques have been used widely in research and for plant propagation, especially in ornamental plants, when it comes to tissue culture woody plants, it's much more difficult in practice due to a number of constraints, some of which I'll be addressing later. Now, it has been some four decades where tissue culture of forestries has been attempted, some successes, some examples of commercialization too. Let us, before that, examine what is the importance of tissue culture or micropropagation in tree breeding and improvement. Now, your trees, all of you know, are unique in the sense that they have very long life cycles. Most of them are very large in size, and many of them have a long juvenile phase. And this causes a lot of problems for conventional tree breeding, which requires generations of scientists. Now, one way of taking advantage of cloning, that is micropropagation or cloning of the plants, is to select the best performing trees, which we call as elites, and then multiply on a large scale so that these can be used as planting material. Now, in many cases, we have a selection of plus trees, which are the superior, phenotypically superior trees, and testing is done in multi-locational trial so that at the end of which we know which are the clones which are really good. And these are then used for large scale micropropagation so that you can develop clonal plantations out of these clones. This schematic diagram will explain how tissue culture will fit in the entire scheme of genetic improvement. I mentioned about plus trees. Now, these can be used for progeny trials in the conventional manner, which takes many years, after which we can select the elites of among them and then send it to the breeding populations, and which produces seeds, but it takes a long time. There is another way by which you clone these plants, either through maintaining hedge gardens and doing vegetative propagation or micropropagation. And this can also be sent for the clonal trials, again leading to some of the selections known as elites, which can be used for future plantations. Or when these clonal seed orchards or seed production orchards become productive, you can get seeds from those. Let's come to some of the important plants in India, and let's examine what is the progress we have been making. In the case of teak, ever since the 1980s, we have been able to tissue culture and get successful regeneration of plants. And axillary bud proliferation and ex vitro rooting is a method adopted. It has been commercialized too, but there is further scope of improvement because of the overall efficiency of the process is still not good. And the other route of somatic embryogenesis, which, as I said, is very useful for developing transgenics, is still an efficient method. So these are the steps through which you go through when you want to clone teak. You start off with buds taken from epicomic shoots maintained in the greenhouse. And through the different stages, you get shoot multiplication. And once you have enough shoots, you root it. And here you don't use a tissue culture method. You treat these cuttings as normal cuttings, induce rootings, and send to the greenhouse. And when the plants are hardened after a few weeks, we can now plant it to the soil. There are still many constraints. Like many trees, we have heavy phenolic exudation when you start the cultures. We need to overcome that. There are different set of methods through which you can get better results. But then in teak, particularly, low multiplication rates of shoot cultures are a serious problem, particularly because we cannot culture it in liquid culture or bioreactors. I'll explain later what the advantages of liquid culture would be. And as I said, the somatic embryogenesis, we have to standardize again. Now, briefly about what is somatic embryogenesis, you can see that somatic embryos are induced from zygotic embryos. we need to find out the right stage of zygotic embryo development, and then we get embryogenesis. We can maintain these cultures for a long time, but conversion to plantlets is difficult. And this is what we get, abnormal plants that develop. So we need to work on this method again. So just to say, tell you how this is an important step. We had attempted developing transgenic teak some years back. This is to find a way of combating the Lepidopteran defoliatis, which are a serious pest of teak. So just like in BT cotton or other crops, we have taken the suitable gene, selected it, found out what is best against the major pests. We transformed embryos with agrobacterium mediated transformation. But then the next stage was the limitation. We couldn't get regeneration of transgenic plants efficiently. So this method still remains the somatic embryogenesis method remains the most promising method to develop transgenics. Coming to bamboo, which is a group of plants which are of great importance these days. Again, micropropagation is very successful in several of the important, economically important bamboo species. Plant regeneration can be obtained through axillary bed proliferation, and callus-mediated somatic embryogenesis is also feasible. But a major constraint is that we cannot get ex vitro rooting, which means that an additional step in tissue culture is required. Somatic embryogenesis too has been achieved in many species. But again, low plant root regeneration frequency is a limitation. The constraints that we face when you do tissue culture of bamboo is high level of microbial contamination at the initial phase. And later on, if you don't remove the contamination, the latent contamination in during the later stages. And low multiplication rate is still a problem in many species. Rooting also is a problem. And there is a unique phenomenon of in vitro flowering, which causes death of cultures, which needs to be overcome. So solutions are that we modify the culture strategy with using explants collected at the right season, improving the cleaning and surface sterilization steps. But more importantly, we use a strategy where biostatic agents like preservative chemicals used in food are used. This is to retain the endophytic organisms without killing them totally, because we have found out in our studies that these endophytes actually contribute through producing plant growth regulators and result in better growth of cultures. And then control of in vitro flowering by manipulating the correct growth regulator concentrations. And the other aspect is reduction in costs of the entire procedure. We have been looking at several ways of doing it. One is use liquid culture systems, and you can see one such here where we use a simple aquarium bio aerator to provide aeration in plastic vessels, and you can see the difference in growth compared to the ordinary vessels. And we can easily do it in polypropylene bag cultures also if you want to reduce the cost further. Scaling up it a little bit, we went for a bioreactor where you have control over pH as well as the aeration. And up to 2.5 months of culture, you can see the mass of shoots that have formed. So there is considerable saving in labor, the skilled labor that is required for doing regular subcultures. So this is one way to go for scaling up bamboo tissue culture. The bamboo, you know, has an underground rhizome system. So if you can, one way of solving the problem of poor rooting is to induce rhizomes while in culture itself. And this, you can see here how a set of rhizomes, micro rhizomes, have been formed, and this results in better survival of the plants. In vitro flowering, you can see the flowers induced in some of the cultures of bamboo. This actually is thought to be an advantage, because we expected that this method could be used for hybrids producing seeds and all, but that has never become a reality. So right now, this is a model system to study the phenomenon of flowering. But when it comes to micropropagation, we would like to prevent flowering, and stresses of different kind, mainly the media and physical conditions provided, induces vitro. So there are ways in which we can avoid each of these stresses. coming to bamboo, you know that bamboo flowers once in a life cycle of around 30 years or more. So getting hybrids are a difficult prospect. But when you use in vitro techniques, there are ways in doing it, like storing pollen, culturing the ovule, doing the in vitro fertilization while in culture. And you can see the some of the examples of hybrid embryos of Gigantius and Asper created using this method. Not much success has been achieved anywhere in the world, except for a few examples in China. But there is a lot of potential here to hybridize different species of bamboo and improve the productivity or the quality of the plants. Coming to another important group of plants, that is the eucalyptus. You know, for industrial biomass production, eucalyptus is an important crop. Several years back, we have achieved a successful regeneration through all the different pathways using axillary buds or through organogenesis or through somatic embryogenesis. It has been possible to induce somatic embryogenesis in liquid suspension cultures too, which means this has good prospects for scale-up. And there have been reports of developing of transgenics. I'll come to it a bit later using the tissue culture route. So we have, these are the examples of these are the cultures of Eucalyptus citrodora, different stages, and plants can be regenerated. And the entire thing is possible in liquid suspension culture. You can see the somatic embryos formed in very large numbers. So this bioreactors can be automated. You don't have to do manual subcultures and other procedures. But one good way to use somatic embryos would be to make artificial seeds. These are meristematic tissue covered with an artificial seed coat so that you can treat them like seeds, hopefully store it, and when you want it, plant it. Now, such efficient plant delivery systems comparable to ordinary seeds are desirable. But in spite of many years of research, we have not yet come anywhere near a good, efficient artificial seed. Many attempts have been made by, for example, encapsulating in alginate. This is how it looks. But only when you put it in a medium do these germinate. And it doesn't work well when you transfer it to the soil because of issues of contamination, issues of not enough oxygen being available for the tissues. But then there are several other designs where Weyerhaeuser company has, for example, devised a paper-based seed with a matrix containing chemicals which hold many times its weight in oxygen. And hopefully such designs will eventually solve the problem of artificial seeds. Here is one application of tissue culture and molecular biology, where they have developed a company called Arborgen has developed a transgenic freeze-tolerant eucalyptus so that the plants can grow in climates, in latitudes where the temperature is falls much below zero. And you can see the comparison made of the control and the transgenic plants and a field where the empty plots are the controls. And this is a gene transcription factor from Arabidopsis, which was introduced into highly productive hybrid eucalyptus. When it comes to sandalwood, which is another important plant tree forestry of India, this has been done for several years now, several decades in fact, but it appears to be that sandalwood is a recalcitrant species. We have multiple shoot formation, but very poor rooting and hardening. Somatic embryos can be produced in a very prolific manner, as you can see in the the photograph here. But the main constraint still remains that somatic embryos cannot be converted to plants. Let's now summarize some of the constraints in tissue culture forestries. Main thing is some of the important species still are not amenable to tissue culture. So much more research is now required. Many of them are related to maturity, because when you want to propagate a mature plant, which is the stage at which you know whether the tree is good or bad, at that stage, culture becomes important, whereas juvenile cultures would be easy to establish. And microbial contamination, as I said, is a big problem in most forestries. Poor rooting and survival of plants is another problem. And the overall production costs are very high in many of the techniques, so that scale-up and commercialization becomes a big hurdle. So some of the issues that still elude solutions are that how do you control somaclonal variation in callus cultures? I mentioned in some of the techniques involve callus, so that plants regenerated need not be true to type. And there are techniques like protoplast culture and anther culture, which yet are not been standardized and do not find any use in breeding applications. So if these techniques can be standardized, these are of great importance to solving many of the hurdles in conventional breeding. Poor rating rates, I told you, is a common problem for many plants, including forestries. Hyperhydrosity, which is when you use cultures using liquid media, there is a problem called vitrification, which results in poor quality. These are common problems which need solutions and a lot of research inputs. Coming to one aspect of it, which we have been working for some time now, how to reduce cost in micropropagation. Many of the protocols are successful only at a lab scale. If you look at the number of papers published where micropropagation has been successful, and the list of plants which are actually commercially micropropagated, there's a huge difference. So scaling up from lab procedures to a higher level, it requires a lot of further inputs. So high multiplication rates and pre-plant regeneration, we have to develop. I would suggest that culture in liquid media and bioreactors for mechanization automation is eventually something that we need to examine, because the labor skilled labor costs are a major share of the cost of the plants. And one technique that has been very not very popular is photoautotrophic micropropagation, of which I will explain a bit later. Some of the cost reduction measures that we have been adopting, it you can use cheaper containers, you replace all the fluorescent tubes with light emitting diodes, which are very common these days. You end up with a lot of energy saving. These are not heating. Use of liquid bedding, I said, because the saving of agar and other equipment is and the labor cost is saved. And you can use in some situations culture in room temperature and daylight. This is not very successful for all stages of culture. And coming to photoautotrophic tissue culture, which I think is a method which has a lot of advantages, but this is a method which requires culture in sugar-free medium with very high levels of CO2 and very high light intensity. At this stage, the tissue cultures are normally not photosynthetic, even if they are green in color. So when under photoautotrophic conditions, plants start photosynthesizing and the physiology improves. And later on, when you regenerate plants, these have a very good chance of surviving. And the entire cost comes down because you're reducing sugar. There is, because sugar is absent, microbial contamination is reduced. And therefore, this is the way forward for many of the plants where right now we don't have efficient methods. These are the typical conditions under which photoautotrophic micropropagation is carried out. High levels of CO2, light intensity, and culture vessels which are not sealed, no sugar. And there are ways of forced ventilation where the air quality changes inside the culture vessels. Many tree species have been successfully cultured under these conditions. So up to 40% lower costs of production can be achieved. So concluding, based on what I've been mentioning in the three examples I gave of teak, bamboo, and eucalyptus, we still have a lot of constraints at various stages of forestry tissue culture. And we need to solve these problems through research. Somatic abrogenesis, which holds great scope for transgenics, needs to be standardized for many species yet. And this has to be done particularly from mature tree tissues. And then even if you have a lab procedure, scaling up and mechanization of the procedure is yet to be a reality in most cases. And In the case of tree species, the mother plant selection, which is very important, has to be done on a scientific basis. It is not enough to do tissue culture with any plant and produce millions of plants. We need to be very careful about which mother plant that you select, whether it has been demonstrated to be performing well. And then we need to integrate tissue culture techniques with the tree improvement programs, which is lacking at present. So coming to the future prospects, I think there is going to be a demand for high performance clones in forestries and also transgenics, though right now in India, this is for forestries, this has not been happening. But micropropagation or rather tissue culture techniques is going to be playing a big role there. And mechanization is going to be the future way of reducing costs. And we need to have suitable protocols standardized to suit those techniques. Somatic emergences using bioreactors and automated plant delivery systems like synthetic seeds is likely to be the most efficient, and we need to work on that. And as I said, phototropic culture systems will be the future for efficient micropropagation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. I think you are ready to take a few questions. We have received a few questions as of now. The first is from Dr. Krishna Kumar. He wants to know about the tissue culture efforts in Nelia species and the success of that.
Well, if you go by published reports, there has not been many papers on Nelia dubia. This plant, the fast-growing plant, is in great demand now. But it doesn't appear to be a very difficult species. I'm sure some of the commercial companies have already mastered that. And I know of one or two people who have been working on it. But I'm not aware of at least published reports where Nelia dubia has been successfully micropropagated. I don't expect it to be a recalcitrant plant. We have not been working on it in KFRA.
Thank you, sir. The second question is from Dr. Sridhar Lakshmi. She wants to know about the status of synchronous flowering in tissue culture plants.
Tissue culture plants are no different from any other clonally propagated plants. So synchronous flowering, which means at the end of the physiological life cycle, when bamboos flower, the tissue culture plants are also expected to flower. And that has been the case so also in many of the tissue culture plantations raised from tissue culture. So it makes no difference whether you do tissue culture or vegetative propagation or seeds.
Thank you, sir. The next question is from Dr. Reshma Paskar. She wants to know on the species teak. What is the difference in productivity in using different explants like leaf, shoot tips, or nodal segments? Is there a difference in productivity and why?
No, the tissues used for culture only matters how quickly or how efficiently you establish a tissue culture. In no way it influences the plant regenerated. What matters is what is the source of your plant. Tissues taken. You're taking it from a juvenile plant or from a mature plant. The genotype which you multiply, that influences the performance of the plants that you generate. It is actually a cloning procedure, so it is just an exact copy of the mother plant. And if you have not done your selection properly, you would end up with plants which are not performing well. And this is, in fact, a very common point that I need to discuss with the people who are interested in tissue culture of teak. There is a huge demand because there have been unscrupulous commercial companies trying to sell tissue culture based on the belief that people have the tissue culture plants perform better. But that's not the case. Unless you start from a plant, a mother plant, which is known to be performing well, you cannot get merely by doing tissue culture any plants that are any better. So tissue culture is just a method of multiplying on a very large scale plants which have been selected based on its performance. And so the first part of selection is most important, not the technology. As I said, tissue culture technology is not very difficult. We have many years experience. The companies that claim that tissue culture will mature in tissue culture teak will mature in 10 years or 15 years are just trying to sell you plants for a high amount. So I would suggest that you keep away from such companies.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Jena also observes that there is a growing demand for Melia dubia, and he wants to know whether there are standard protocols available.
As I said earlier, standard protocols are not very high in number because this plant has gained importance only in the last decade or so. It's a very fast growing tree, and for fast rotation plantations is very ideal. And I know that some selections have been done by many states where good performing clones are available. And it would be a matter of using it for tissue culture to generate very high numbers. I'm not sure about any commercial companies actually producing it through tissue culture because rooted cuttings and seeds are working fine. But tissue culture would enable you to produce very large numbers. Yes.
So the next question is from Mr. Jagadish. He wants to know the approximate cost required to establish a small unit tissue culture lab at college level.
Okay, for a college level or a home level or a hobbyist level, I would say that if you are not interested in going for the sophisticated equipment, you could establish something as little as 4-5 lakhs. But if you're looking at a commercial scale, then anything less than 30-40 lakhs wouldn't be at the bare minimum. But you're looking at a very large scale unit, it will run into crores because you will have multiple units of every equipment. You will have a lot of people working there, a lot of infrastructure required. But if you're looking at doing tissue culture on a very small scale, it can be done even at your home. Many people do it for orchids. In that case, you're not investing in anything other than a pressure cooker and a lamina flow, which costs something like 50,000 to 1 lakh. Air-conditioned room, where you have a fairly clean environment, temperature maintained to around 25 degrees, and a lot of fluorescent tube lights, which provide the light. And a lab where you can mix the chemicals and formulate the media. So a pH meter would be required. So this, I think, at the bare minimum, you could start off with something like 5 to 10 lakhs, if you are seriously interested in it.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Badish wants to know about the use of lights in the tissue culture room. He wants to know whether the LED light will innervate the somatic hydrogen synthesis, and is it possible to use LED lights in a tissue culture lab?
It can be. For many years now, I've been replacing all the fluorescent lights with LED lights of the same category, cool daylight type. Now, the advantage with LEDs is that besides the energy saving, the output is very uniform and very precise. It is even possible for you to fabricate LED lights with a precise frequency, so and mix different LED lights of different colors to get exactly what you want. So much more control over the quality of light is possible. And otherwise, for general tissue culture, since I've been using it for the past 10 years, I find hardly any difference from as far as the response in tissue culture is concerned. But I'm dealing mostly with shoot cultures. And specifically for a particular species, somatic emergences, there is surely an effect of light quality there. But LEDs by per se compared to white fluorescent tubes, I don't expect any great difference. The advantages are for the LED. I hope I've answered your question.
Thank you, sir. The next question is regarding the use of CRISPR technology in tissue culture. How beneficial will be the CRISPR-Cas9 for production of transgenic species in forestry?
Yeah, this is with the advent of this technique, it has become more feasible, more easier to modify, genetically transform plants. But as far as tissue culture is concerned, it makes no difference whether the recombinant DNA comes through the traditional method or through CRISPR-Cas. Eventually, when you put a gene inside or modify the gene inside the tissues, you have to regenerate plants out of it to get a full plant. So it makes no difference from the tissue culture point of view whether you are using CRISPR-Cas or the conventional genetic transformation methods.
Thank you, sir. We move over to Dr. Shyam Vishwanath, director, who would give an institutional overview on tissue culture research at KSRI and the future prospects.
Thank you, Dr. Sajeev. As far as R&D institutions are concerned, institutions like KFRI or any other R&D institutions, the ideal strategy would be to develop the protocols for each of the species. And then the commercialization, it is better that R&D institutions don't go in for commercialization because that involves a lot of labor, manpower, and many other things, marketing skills and all that. The ideal thing would be to transfer the protocol with an MOU with any private entity, and the private organization can carry forward this commercialization aspect with technical inputs from the R&D organization. So that is the way forward that we are looking, especially in the case of bamboo, teak. Meliodubia is one species that we at KFRI, we are not given our attention so far, but I know that other institutes of ICFRE like IWST, they have developed protocols, and the commercialization of that is possible, you will have to contact those organizations. So what Dr. Mudli was saying, in a nutshell, that yes, tissue culture for forestry species is the way forward. The only thing is that don't get over enthused or taken in by claims by certain private organizations that tissue culture plants would give you better yield or all that, faster returns over a shorter gestation period. These all depend on the genetic makeup and the selection of the mother plant. So in a nutshell, that's what as an institution, KFRI would like to say. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We have one more question from Dr. Reshma. Reshma asks that you have observed that the productivity of peak micropropagation depends on selection of superior flow. And so, what are the ways to assess the superior growth outcome?
Beg your pardon, what are the ways in which? I didn't get the last part of it. There's some audio problem. Is it Reshma? Okay. Okay. What we normally do is we have an array of clones selected based on the mother plant phenotype. And these clones have been put in multi-locational trials. Some of them are through rooted cuttings, some of them through tissue culture. And these are put in different agroclimatic zones. Following a statistical model where which permits us to evaluate the performance, and it takes at least minimum of 1/3 of your rotation cycle to assess, because these are timber trees. You need to have the heartwood formation before you can make any assessments. Right now, KFRI is in the middle of doing such a trial. This has been done in some other organizations, for example, in Malaysia, where they have actually taken the core samples even before the plant has attained the maximum size, and then assessed how the plant is performing. So performance of this clones in multi-locational trial is only way of knowing whether the clones we have selected is actually a high-performing clones. The normal process, result of that would be that some of the clones are rejected, some others are actually registered as a specific clone, so that this can then be multiplied on a large scale and made available to people. Like, for example, eucalyptus and poplar, it is being done for many years now. We hope that such a stage we'll achieve in a few years from now, when our field trials are completed.
Thank you, sir. We have no more questions as of now. Thank you for answering all the questions. And KFRI looks forward to your active participation in the forthcoming webinars. We'll be announcing the webinars, forthcoming webinars soon, and we will informing it the specific date and time to you through email. In case you have any specific comments on the webinars, you can mail to our director. The email address is given in the chat box, director@kfra.org. Thank you all for both and attending this interesting webinar. Thank you to Dr. P.M. Muralitharan for making such a wonderful presentation, to Dr. Shyam Vishwanath who gave an overview of tissue culture research from the institutional perspective. Thank you all. We'll meet next time. Take care of your health and be in lockdown. Thank you.
Thank you all for participating.